going back, coming out of the posterior, full circle. Like up clear. Alright, so my plan is that programming the posterior is good to know. Otherwise, what we're talking about. It's good for understanding how languages work, comparing them, how languages are going to work a lot of the time, and coming out with new languages. If you start going down the FP rabbit hole, eventually you'll come across blog posts and papers and some of them contain annotation or definitions that you may not be familiar with. And a lot of it, not all of it, but you know, some of it is likely to come from the PLT literature. And yeah, once you're comfortable enough to get started, you can generally keep going. So there's a few little bits that people tend to hit that are very, very fine. This is them. With animated LaTeX slides to try and make them less frightening. And after that, it should be good to go with more of this. Or you have it. So,
yeah. Yep, I get it.
If I do it, we'll scream it everyone for you. Testing. Yeah, cool. I came across some of this notation when someone said, oh, Haskell papers are easy to read. And on page 2, they added a language feature in 2 columns and proved that it worked, and then spent 14 pages discussing, you know, the consequences of that change. And it seemed to use some notation that was consistent for the term and the type changes, and it just made no sense to me. But I wanted that superpower. But yeah, we just had that, and then things happened. So that's how I got here. That and caffeine and time. So, it's not as scary as it seems. That's not the same one as scary. So, never not too much stuff gets covered, and that's going to be good old. I'll deal with that again too. Right, so here is a thing from PLT and how it's usually presented. Notation. We're going to be covering that. If you don't find that scary at all, then maybe you've already covered this or you're used to this notation. But when I first came across that, I had no idea what was going on. So, this is about getting started with it. Maybe not fully comfortable, but at least not scared. There'll also be little bits of, not just notation, but also bits in the domain of languages. There are a couple of them on it. And if you want more of this, there's a textbook, Types of Programming Languages, where you prove the various properties of what we're talking about in pen and paper, or there's software foundations, where you prove using the computer, so you don't need pen and paper, and you can automate proofs. Both very, very good, both kind of out of the scope of this talk, but this will. If you like the flavor you're getting from this, there's plenty more to tap into later on. Cool. So, the first bit of the notation we're going to cover is the natural deduction rules. Most of the things we use in this, with 2 exceptions, are going to be done in the style. We have a little man, or name, as I like to pronounce it. Above the line, we have the assumptions that must hold for the rule to apply. Beneath the line, we have the conclusion. That's very abstract. Let's get concrete. Evenness across natural numbers. 0 is even. That's what the top rule is saying. It has no assumptions above the line, so it's an axiom. If you're familiar with proof systems, axioms are the things that are just true. Below the line, we're saying x plus 2 is even, provided x is even. You're even above and below the line, so it's a recursive rule, which is fine. And we union all the rules together, and whatever rules we've got, and the union of them is, that's what we're planning. So if we lose something out, things break, put too many things in, then we might be okay. And we're only applying one rule at a time, so in that sense, the order that we apply the rules doesn't matter. When we go into this thing, we want to make sure that that's still true, and we'll check that later. And we're dealing with open world. So we can add things in later on, go back and modify things, or we should. Right, so let's add some stuff. So now we have oddness added in, and there's a lot of stuff going on. If we're trying to prove the evenness of four by looking through these rules, we can do, we can add two twice, get that to zero, or we can jump through even an odd until we amend the root of plus two. There's a few different parts that we could apply these rules. And that can be confusing. But what the main property we're looking for here is the determinism. No matter which path we take to get there, it should always give the same answers. Probable paths aren't scary as long as they're consistent. If they're inconsistent, then you've got something that probably isn't PLT at that point. You've just got a rule system that's doing stuff. Which could be fun. Occasionally we come across some things that are clearly not fun. It could be mathematically convenient to specify rules like this. The symmetry rule there, you can just keep applying that any even number of times and you haven't really gone with that. So you can have a, if you did a breadth first search, if you did a depth first search for all the derivations, you could also make cross time. It just keeps it going, increasing. But it can be useful for, if you're doing the whole proofs and you're really doing the formalizing things to have that rule system upgrade. So if you come across something that looks like that, it's normally there for a reason. And if the author of the paper or blog post doesn't hit you, they'll also give you another set of rules called the algorithmic rules that help drive an implementation. They won't have the same nice mathematical properties that they're shooting for with the other ones, but they'll generally have the two sets of rules, one of them for maths people, one of them for engineers, and they'll prove that the rules are logically equivalent. So it may be a little bit harder to pull out what you need for the maths from the algorithmic ones, but the proof of equivalence is enough that you've got soundness. So that's just a little bookmark for if you're running stuff like that. Because depending on which paths you are, you can run that quickly. And then just grab the algorithmic ones and keep digging. There's a little bit of Haskell here. Who's not comfortable with Haskell? Just show of hands, no shame. So the point of this talk is not the Haskell. The reason the Haskell is here is that all the Haskell is to show that one, the code exists, and I'm not just saying, yeah, you can implement this. And the code is actually quite short. So that's the only reason the Haskell's up there. If you don't know the Haskell, just check your phone for a minute or two when I get through the Haskell bits. Or use it for inspiration. If I'm wanting to learn our courses at one point, I need to learn that because this is really great. So, white noise playing for non-Haskellers, for everyone else. If we have an applicative F, manages some kind of effect, we could, for some of them, we can make an instance of the alternative type class. So empty is the kind of nothing going on value. And then we have this effectful or operation. So we give them two things, pick one of them. And I'll usually be left biased. For the maybe type, we have one of these instances. So two nothings, which is nothing, we expect. If we have just a one and nothing, it'll choose just a one. Nothing and just two, it'll choose a two. And because it's left bias, we get just one. All right, so that's two things. Well, if we have more than two things there, glad you asked. We have the ability to take a container for all these things and compress them down. We just go through them all, applying probably what you want to apply here. That looks like this. These three things, pick the first one. Pick the first one, it's not nothing. And if we give it nothing, we get nothing. Okay. All of this is leading up to my crazy implementation of the rule system, which is again just a proof of existence that you can do these things that are quite common. You grab it as an oral test, you don't even remember it. A rule set is goes from A to BD, so it may go from some kind of term to another term, which is a unit, to say it's properly balanced. Even go from the natural numbers to unit, so this thing applies with the non-linear value if the rule applies, if the rule set applies. The individual rules that make up a rule set have access to the rule set, recursive, so you can do those recursive rules. And this is how we do it, which is the crazy time of the knot. So each of the rules, we run over them. We run the rule with the rule set that we're currently creating and the value, and then we sum them together, and then we're done, and we've got no one else. some detailed questions if they're not comfortable with raising this and type it up. But they just kind of general in there and run away, and then you don't need to worry about it. Alrighty. This is what a rule looks like for an answer. This is something with 0 is even. So if x is 0, then yes, the rule applies. Otherwise, there's not really what we're looking for. That's 2 or less for that. Is that at 2? Because we use units rather than naturals, it's a little bit icky. So we just check it within bounds and then recursively call the even rule on something a little bit smaller. And we put them together and we have our even rule. We can pass in the odd function and create the even odd, and pass in the even function and create odd even. The details don't really matter. We put them together, we even put in a whole bunch of rules, and here we go, that's it. 3, not even. 4, even. 3 is odd, and 4, not odd. So it's working. Cool, that's, so the rule system works in that little pregnant convention. Nothing else is still just the whole point. Let's write a language. That's right, the dumbest, simplest language I've ever heard. A language of integers. So we're going to look at terms for our integer language. This is the kind of formal messy way of describing the terms. We have integers, these little triangle brackets, etc. Just regular integers rather than having any other introductory forms. Or we can add two of them together. These are the pieces of the language and ways of combining them. It's a recursive definition. It's also referred to as the abstract syntax. It's not the concrete syntax because we don't care about commas and spaces and whatnot, but these are the pieces and ways you combine it to make it kind of grammar efficient. And thus, and of course, doesn't count. Here's an integer. And in that schema, here's another integer. If you can have them together and they're still in an integer line. I can write the Haskell version of this. Integers, just wrap up a Haskell integer, add recursively those two terms in it. And then I can recreate those terms in Haskell. So this is my 3 in the language. And this is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 fit. Lots of adds, stuff going on, but it's just a data type, but a value of the data. So, what are the values for the language? We're going to define the values for this language to be just integers. It's a subset of the syntax of the language. So just by looking at the pieces that make up a term and how they combine, we should be able to point to figure that. That's about it. There shouldn't be any kind of extra computation to go, oh, is it? No, we should just be able to look at it. We could also go by rules, which helps around putting these things together. Right. So when we evaluate a term, we're turning it into a value. So the values are the endpoints. When we're evaluating 1 plus 2, we have what? Not a value. We get 3, not much more than a value. That's the point of values. And the part of the syntax of language. So if we're picking out something from the parts and how we combine, those are values. Now the evaluation itself proceeds in steps. And these 7 steps, in this case, we use these small steps in the actual language. They're what it means to, what does 1 plus 2 mean? Well, it means that you evaluate the answer and then level 3. That's not syntactic. Cool. Now, the steps are specified as a binary array. T1 arrow T2. And that means that T1 can step to T2. That takes one step of computation, and it's just a little bit closer to being that. Right. So, for addition, the important bit is that if you have ever had 2 integers, and you've been told to add them together, you should add them together. This is important. If you don't have 2 integers, well, panic, right? If the left-hand argument can take a step, then take the step and pack it back up, and then you're a little bit closer. Now, assuming the left-hand argument is already a value for an integer, but the right-hand argument can take a step, then you take a step and you pack it back up. And once the new euro has been told, assuming no one's crazy past because you've got a broken language and can't discriminate, you can have an inventory of the side and you can turn it into that. This is also introducing small bias in that it's kind of doing left first evaluation. You could design a language that is biased towards the right. That's cool. We use a little bit of a notational convenience. Rather than testing that T1 is available, we just use V rather than T to refer to it. And there's an implicit test that they in EA2 that the first argument is about. Save some time, and you'll see that everywhere in the literature. So that won't surprise you. Well, it might, because there's a lot of stuff in this talk and you're going to forget tons. But the slides are not fine, so we should be. But so this is the complete semantics of our literature. Step to the left, and then jump to the right, and then adherence, and you can do it. Right. So, a few definitions. These things will float around, and you can see in the stereos are the same thing when they're not, so we're covering them. If the term can't take a step, it's a normal form. Values can't take a step by definition, so they're normal forms. If you iterate the small step relation, it's going to reach a value. It's called evaluation. Just keep stepping, get a value, evaluate. If you just keep stepping until you get a normal form, that's called normalization. And at this point, people are like, well, okay, that's the same thing, right? You put it for the same thing. If everything is right in the world, it's the same thing. If the term is not a value, but is a normal form, so we've got something that's built in pieces, what do we do next? Yeah. Then it's stuck. So you can normalize it, you can have it validate. You do not want stuck terms. We'll get back to that in some detail soon. So if someone says a language is normalizing, it means there's an evaluation order through which you can take a finite size term and get it down to a normal form in finite time. If it's strongly normalizing, it means the evaluation order doesn't matter. Pick up the scheme and go for it and you're going to get there. Strongly normalizing is good. It means your finite terms evaluate in finite time. And you can take that to that. No halting problems here, is what that's saying. And that is a great problem to have if you can get the work done. So we've already got something cool going on. We've got values and normal forms and similar things, but values are purely syntactic and normal forms are semantic. And then we've got this relationship between them, and they're misaligned their stuff. We've got these concepts coming from putting those two things together, which I find cool. It's a cool thing coming. This is all from level definitions. If you see a big error, then you're dealing with big step semantics, which is tell me how to get to the end, how to jump right to a value. And you can kind of turn the small step semantics and big step semantics using this thing. And then you don't have values. Values, big step to values, and then just if you see that, you'd be well equipped to pick up a textbook and understand it after this. Right. So let's be an evaluator. We're going to do this addition from the example before, and we're going to do it with another form of this syntax that pops up all over the place instead of the right one I came across. This is an easy one to get started, and we'll do crazier and crazier ones as we go along. So, what are we adding? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4. Well, what rule should we apply? Well, is this first argument a value? Here, so the EAD1 rule, which we see on the right there, applies. So we shift that up. And have a look at that. Value on the left, value on the right. Add int applies. Alright, 1 plus 2 is going to become 3. And that has been dragged down to the lower line. And so that's our one step of evaluation. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 and 3 plus 3 plus 4. That's what we've got. We'll bring it down to our next step. And we'll do something similar. 3 is a value. 3 plus 4 isn't. So add together to make it a value. We bring it down. And then we have 3 plus 7, which is 2 integers added together. And then we've got 10. Rules, for variables, non-hash variables. budget is good. We have a very simple set of rules, parameters. And we have this big thing, this is value. Now, let's sort of work here. 10, value. So, my value thing's working. For running through our rules, if we want to step our left-hand term, then we recursively use our step function to move forward. We'll package it up again. This is making use of the fact that we're in the menu line, so that if we can't step, that thing will just go on and we'll multiply, which is handy. Stepping on the right, with access to a value function, looks like this. Check that the first element's a value, and then step the second element and package it together. But we could just peek, because we've got a very simple language, and say the first argument is int, these are the values, and start folding the stuff together. If you're actually writing a value, you're probably folding the rules together because it's more efficient. But, you know, some people, sure. And then adding integers together, unpacks the images, adds them together, repacks them. Good to go. Right. And we list the rules, and we have a step function. So, with this beast, if we step it, we can see 1 plus 2 became 3. If we do 2 steps, if 3 plus 7, if we do 3 steps, we have 10. This is just like our diagram before, but in Haskell and not Pylon. If we do another step, we have that step, that no rules apply. If we wanted to automate that, we can just keep applying the function until we hit nothing, and then show the thing just before, and then get just the eval function. So that 4 lines of code thereabouts, and then we just set eval by 10. We have an evaluator who rules to rules. Sweet. So we get our first property that we would like to hold, which is that our terms are not stuck. I put the maths up because you'll come across the maths and the definition of these properties. Eventually get used to it. So for all terms, the term is either a value or it's able to stop. There exists another term that we can stop to. That is something that we quite like. This is another existence proof. As well as writing code, I've written some property based tests for this, just to show that there's nothing on my sleeve or to show that these things fail. You can randomly generate terms. Here's a whole heap of them that are randomly generated. The top line one is the one that initially generates, and we'll check some code to see whether this property holds. And if it fails, it will shrink it to these things to try and find the minimum counter example. So that I don't have to try and test a whole heap of stuff. I can just say, this should hold for all terms, and we'll find the smallest one of these that fails or tell me that everything is good. So we have a property that says, if you give me something that you can generate, and two rules, make sure that if one of them is nothing, the other one isn't. So exactly one of these rules will work. And I use that to say that exactly one of those in step will work for the terms. And the main thing that matters here is that works. Try 100 different random values, if you hit a problem, but shrink it down. Yeah, my tiny, tiny, tiny simple language is in the code. In my 2 dozen lines of code, whatever it was. Alright. So, enough of these simple languages. Let's do another simple language. Booleans. True, false, and OR are the family. True and false are values. OR is the thing we're doing. We have two different versions of this. For one of them, our OR function wants to have all the information we get hold of. So they're going to fully evaluate both sides down to values, and then use a truth table-like construction to pick out the result. If we don't want to do all that work necessarily, we can just evaluate down on the left-hand side, and then once we get a concrete value, we know what to do next. So a false OR term is term, true OR something is, who cares? It's true, but I and that's a good preview of lazy residue. We're going to do a little bit more of that, but that's kind of where it's coming from. And it feels very different when you're applying it top down using a lazy language, for instance. Or it can, but those are the origins of it. So the hex conversion, false true and all, a value, false is a value, true is a value, and those are all of our values. For the eager version, we step on the left, we step on the right, if the left side is a value, and then we have a big truth table. And we put a big truth table together and have our eager or. From the lazy version, we do our short second, combine, and we do. So, let's do an eager step of this one, and we'll collapse the left argument, and another eager step, we'll collapse the right argument. The third eager step, we're done. And the fourth eager step is no bueno, because it's a value. If we do this lazily, we'll value on the left, and it'll be true. The second step will just give us the answer. We don't need to do that computation on the right, because we know enough. Cool. And grand failure stops. Another property, these rules are deterministic. For all terms, if the term can take a step, and if there is some other step we can take in that initial term, both of those outputs will agree. This comes into play in fancier languages when you're doing it purely mathematically, but it's a good property for us to have in Haskell land, because in maths land we have sets of rules and we have lists of rules. So we kind of want to make sure that the order of our rules is important, because the theory says the order is important, and if depending on them somehow, then we're probably broken stuff. So, again, we randomly generate terms, and we say, given a rule set, just randomly shuffle it twice and create the rule, with the rules in different order. If the rules are in different orders, you create the rule and then run it, it should be. And then we say that the eval rules should be deterministic for the lazy and the eager evaluation. And it is happy. There will be a slight one too. We can step it up a tiny bit more in the simple cases, and then we'll do something interesting. Natural numbers, if you come across them before, they're either zero or the successor of a natural number. It's kind of a year in the number system, just how many fingers do you have? And you just add them up. So zero and successor are natural numbers, and predecessor is the function we're applying on these things. In the eager case, our values are zero, or the successor of any natural number that is composed purely of successes and zero. So, zero is three, and that is totally a value. In the lazy case, if it's a zero, if it starts with a successor, it's probably good enough. And if it's got some other stuff in there, we'll do it that way. So this is clearly one. Successor is three, in eager case. It's got some work to do in the eager case to resolve what it actually is. But in a lazy system, it's totally a value. Natural numbers are zero successes in things. And if there's some computation in the thing, then we'll find out about that later, and that'll be fine. So the eager rules, we step through our successes, because we need to get it to a value there. We step through our predecessors. Predecessor is zero and zero. We can find the natural numbers at that point. And the predecessor or the successor of the value is just the value. But we need to get to the value first, so everything else needs to be punched away from it. In lazy land, we step through our predecessors. If we hit zero, we return zero. If we hit a predecessor-successor pair, we just return whatever's inside of it. No more computation, just get rid of that pairing, and we get this useful info. Cool. So, on the lazy evaluation, both of these are one. It's only a one in the eager case for the first one. If we're doing eager evaluation, we don't want any computation in our values. That's kind of the core thing. And in the lazy evaluation, we don't want to do any work that we don't need to. So that's the core kind of tension between the two. So this is fine in lazy land, zero is successor of a number. But if we use the predecessor, if we take the predecessor of that, then we're kind of tickling it and saying, hey, wake up and give me an answer. So the outer predecessor pair will be removed, and we've still got a pred, so we've still got questions to answer. complete alarm, it's successful. No one calls permanent, no one cared about it enough to ask. So we just leave it. And implementing these is zeros about year. I can probably just gloss through this because I don't think we use it much, except for successors, predecessors, zero, and the E version. Also, yeah, right, cool. So, eagerly, we step through this, it peels off the pair, and we get one, and we keep going, it stops. Lazily, we don't even step. As a successor, it is a bird. Whereas if we wrap the predecessor around and ask a question, then everything still works for eager, up until the point we did earlier. And we actually cause the lazy version to do some work. Until we get to go. And it just works. Cool. Now, this is where things start to get a little bit more interesting. We combine it. Booleans are natural numbers. And then because they sit in their own little domains, we have a few functions that cross the streams, which is good, apparently. So you can check whether something is zero, and they can run if then else. These are our new little non-volume forms. If we're checking if something is zero, then we keep stepping through. If it's zero, then we say true. If it's an accessor or something, we say false. Under eager semantics, we'll wait until it's a value before we answer. Lazy semantics, as soon as we see a successor, then we know an answer and we ship it. And if we step through our initial, and if that hits true, we take the first branch, and if it's false, then we take the second branch, because you don't want to do both things down if, and then decide. You kind of do your condition one first. It's kind of like inherently lazy. So now, we're going to stop tonight. This is not a value, it can't take a step. Zero or false. What do we do? Similarly, if zero, then false or true in a same language is not something you can consider. But one thing that happens in books when you hit this is they break values down further. Yay. So you have your Boolean values and your natural values, and you combine them together, and you have your rules here. Run this and see if you get it. Just a natural value. Cool, this is still stuck. It doesn't help you that you've restricted it to, you know, you have communicated intent very clearly, and that's excellent. It doesn't help you look at a term and say, oh, that one's going to get me in trouble. Because you've got to run it until you hit something. And so here we have the, you must be what exactly one of the value of the step, and I ran my random test, and after 14 tests and 5 shrinks, it came up with all 0, 0. And it's like, that's not a value, that can't take a step. And same for the lazy, that's lazy, and ego said, process for false is true. Alright, that's fair. Alright, so what we want is to work out which terms will or won't get stuck without having to evaluate the term. Because it could be quantum problems or U.S. problems, you know. I've got this implementation of the acronym function, and I just want to make sure that it's, you know, prototyped, but I'll just run it for a bit. You know. So, this is where types come into play. We have two types at the moment, rules and mats. We're using them to classify kind of the sorts of things, and this is a cheap method to classify, up to attempt to classify things into a stuff or a nuts, which is cool. This is the typing relation. It's ternary. It's one of the scary things that I ran into the first time I saw it, because I didn't know what was going on, and it just looks broken. We're saying little t is well typed, and has typed big T inside of the context again. So I'll take it back there. So we have some context, some information, and based on that information, we say the term has this type. At the moment, we don't have any relevant context, so we're just saying little t has type big T. And we can begin. False has type boolean. We don't care about context. True is also boolean. If t1 and t2 are booleans, then all has type boolean. This is going well. And it's an open world, so I can say that, and not saying anything about apples until later. We can also use the check something. I expect false to be a rule. Right, I'm going to go up. Yep, that's cool. We can also use it to infer. I have false, it's a time. And we can kind of methodically look through this and actually point rule out as an answer. So that's kind of cool. At the moment, we have what's called a syntax directed language, so we can actually walk through the syntax together and infer and then speed it by that and infer and draw a check, which is a nice property to have, but sometimes you want a bit more power. That may well come up with that in the future. Cool. Natural numbers. Zero is a natural number. Successor with a natural number is a natural number. Predecessor with a natural number is a natural number. And the bridge between the two worlds. If t is a natural number, then E0t is a boolean. If t1 is a boolean and t2 and t3 are the same, then if t1 and t2 does t3, has that same type. This is a rules out the stuck terms we saw previously. If 0 false doesn't apply to a wrong, don't touch, be wrong. And if 0 then false, false true, also wrong. Unfortunately, we've ruled out a non-stuck term. This term is not stuck. If true then 0 else true, we'll always evaluate to 0. But our typing system will reject it. Oh no. Actually, it's fine. We're dealing with something called a conservative type system. A lot of type systems are conservative. It turns out a lot of the time we can work around whether that means it or what actually. But just use thinking another definition of this thinking example. For each well type term, we'll have a unique type at the moment, or the whole way through this talk. Later we'll relax that and be more concerned with the principal type of the term, whether you have your types, you will pick one and say that's the one you like. Alright. Second experience, work through of notation possibly. We're going to type that term on the wall. But we're going to work out its type. So it's an if then else. So the two if rule applies. So we check the first bit. Is there a successor is zero? And we'll need to check that, we need to check its item, successor is zero. And we'll check that, we need to check zero. And then when you hit gold, we know this one. Zero is a natural number. And that means successor is zero is a natural number, which means is zero successor is zero, is well typed as a boolean. The next one, quite easy, false. False, boolean. Sweet. We've warmed up at this point. True or false? We check true as a boolean. Which are false as a rule, both of the rules are all works. And now we have if rule is correct, both branches are the same rules, and this thing is a rule. If you do it without the colors in the talking, and you just stare at it, you have the potential to confuse yourself. Wrong. Cool. We can implement this. We create our types. We start with checking. So give me a term type there. And I'll tell you whether that is that term has that particular type. So is zero has type boolean that is correct provided its item has type map. If we check the first one, has type more, and the other two items have the same as the term type. And we have this bad term here that has successor false in it. And if we check, then has type rule, we have nothing. Fix that up. Check those type normal, it says yes. Also, it does not have the type map. So we have a type checker for each. If we do these things to check whether or not types are equal and fail or not fail based on that, we can also refer to this. So this is taking a term and returning a type. So it's doing inference. So if is error, if the term has type map, then return bool, and we have returns to types. And for if we check the condition is type bool, and then we check that the two branches are bringing the types and return that type. And from that, we can infer that the type of our bool types term is nothing, and if we fix it up, then that comes cool, which is correct. At this point, if you're going through the code, our property-based testing gets a little bit more extreme. We start generating goal type terms. then we can check that if we generate a term with a given type, that checking that that term has that type succeeds, and inferring the type of the term agrees with the type that we generated. That works. Cool. All right, now coming up on a key point, that's good. There are two main properties for a type system that we want. And I relate the small step semantics with the type regulation, and it's pretty awesome. The first is progress. For all well-typed terms, the term is either a value or is able to take a step. Just like the term is good, but the scope is the well-typed terms. And the other one is preservation. If you give me a well-typed term and it can take a step, then afterwards the type will be the same. And they give us type set. The old type terms do not get stuck. So that is combining syntax, semantics, and typing in one statement. And it only took people 30 years to get there, dozens of people working on it, so bring the game so that you get that little pithy bumpy sticker of a result. So progress means the old type term is either a value or a take it. If you're a value, you're done. Hey, you have evaluated something. If not, you can take a step. But preservation means that as you take the step, you still have that same time. And so progress applies. So you're either a value or you can take a step. And as long as you find the size, you're eventually going to hear about it without exploding. So you're not stuck. Hey, if you're the size, you're in the right place. Well, there's other things about it. Yeah, so they tie together a big three. And they give us approximate classifiers which terms might not get stuck. Proportional to the size of the term in this case. And we can implement this in probability-based testing, what the main thing is, the classes. And the next main thing is pizza, and then I'll come through and really call that in that.
Someone who gives us the sine function, we're going to be creating functions out of whole cloth on our own, and then using that. So, hey, there are three things that we add to the language to get to this point. We have variables, like x there. We have what's called a lambda abstraction, lambda x and then t, which is a function, effectively, and then function implication. You give me a function and an argument, and I'll apply the argument to the function. The only values in there are the lambdas. And there's no steps for the variables. They're neither steppable nor values. So just by default, they're stuck. So, deal with that. We'll cover that. So when we're dealing with a lambda, there's some. The x to the left of the dot is called a variable binding, and to the right of the dot is the variable itself. So we'll have a look at some terms. So this term means nothing. This is a variable x. No good. X plus 2 also doesn't pass minus 2. This, however, is fine. Lambda x plus 2 is the same as the function of the bottom here. F of x equals x plus 2. It's a function, it takes an x, the body of the function is x plus 2, we just haven't had to come up with a name. If we apply 1 to that function, that is the same as f1. We just got brackets on the other side of things, and we haven't had that function. And if we were to evaluate that in maths land, so f1, we take f of x equals x plus 2, and we replace all the x's by 1's. That's the step that we're doing. I don't really talk through that explicitly when I talk about functions in school, or maybe they do, it's been years.
I'm going to say that, right? Oh. We have notation for that, because we love notation. This means go through F and replace every X you see with a 1. And we'd like to see something similar happening when we do a configuration, right? So go through this and replace all the X's with 1s, and drop the lambda, because we've already used that. That should be good. And we need to be careful when we're doing that. So here's something with a lot of X's, and we're going to replace X's with 3s. But there's a trap here. So when we do this, we want to get this lambda x, x plus 1, with 3 plus 1 applied to it. You don't want to go into that function on the left and replace all the x's, because otherwise you have a bad time. So in order to do that, we need to work out which variables we want to replace. We call the free variables. A variable is bound, which is the opposite of free, effectively. If it appears inside a lambda instruction with a variable, only matching variable body. So here x is bound by the lambda, and then we use it, it's bound. Here x is free. Oh no, bad news. Well, if we're living that way. And a variable can be free and bound in the same term. So x is free here, but it's bound here. They're effectively different x's at this point. So what we really want to do is go through and replace all the free occurrences of x with 3. And that'll give us the right value. Replacing the bound ones, no problem. Everything falls apart. Cats and dogs look together. One thing we could do with the bound variables, one we can do at any point is to just consistently rename. One changes the meaning of the program, and that kind of highlights the behavior we see there should be the same if those z's were x's, and that kind of highlights the go through and replace all the free occurrences. The occurrences of elements. So, we have some rules, not in natural direction style. Sorry. I know you all love the natural direction style now, but this is what we've got. To determine the free variables of an expression, well, the free variable of a variable is a variable. In a lambda, we grab the free variables in the body and we discard the lambda argument. For application, we just grab the free variables everywhere. Basically, we're just walking through finding all the variables down the leaves, and then discarding one, the bound variable, remember we have a lambda. So we can walk through that with this bad boy. This is a function application. So we're going to be unioning the three variables on either side, like so. We have a function on the left, so this rule applies. So we're going to grab the three variables of the body, and then strip out the x. Now we can apply some set theory. We have a set, three variables of x plus 1. We chop off the x and we union it with the set, three variables of x plus 1. Well, that's just the three variables of x plus 1. And that saves me slide space, which is, set theory logic, all about slide space. For x plus 1, we take three variables of both arguments, and the three variables of x, and the three variables in 1 is nothing. So, we can do that calculation, we'll see these rules that come up in the middle of something that's doing natural direction everywhere, and it can be a bit of a surprise. So, now that we have the three variables, we can do substitution properly. And, I have a shiny laser, you can see we can use the three variable thing there, in like one case. And there's big other rule system. So how do you write it for the free variable? This is how to replace x with s in all of these forms. In x, you return s. If you hit a variable that isn't x, then you leave it alone. Similarly, if you're hitting a lambda where that variable is bound, you leave it alone. And otherwise, you go through and substitute, provided the thing you're replacing it with doesn't have your bound variable as a free variable. Otherwise, you're going to be introducing variables that you know, confuse matters, and you stop from your renaming, and it's wrong. And otherwise, you just kind of recursively go through your turn, doing substitutions on all the bits. I'll give an example because
plug all the bugs I can find with funny arrows. So, the function application, we do the substitution for either side, so, and then we're doing working with a lambda with the down variable. So, substituting for x and lambda x, leaves it alone. And then we're substituting, replacing x with 3 and x plus 1. We go through the plus, we go to both arguments. And now we're replacing x with 3 and x. So we finally get our 3, and then 1 is unchanged. And we've done the right thing. Alright. So, we used 3 variables in that one little place in the substitution rules. And now we have substitution rule defined. So we're going to use a one little place in the small steps of methods. This is as complicated as it gets. 3 levels of rules, and then you get the functions. You get used to it. In the eager semantics, if you're applying a value to a function, you step the thing on the left towards a value. If that's already a value, you step the thing on the right towards a value. And eventually, you can end up with a lambda and a value. So go through the body of the lambda, replacing the x's with the arguments, is what that bottom line says. Go through and replace x with the value in the body, and then you've done function application. If you're lazy, then you don't even get as a value. Just as soon as you see the lambda, just replace something, and someone else can compute it if they want to play it. The Haskell implementation, you either the Haskell, really look away. We have this term, which has a type variable A, which is for the type of variables in this thing, and it's a functor, formal, and traversable, and it's a for all across the 3 variables in this. And part of that comes from the script, like type in A. We also have in the monad instance, which is also across the 3 variables, the term is your variable, and our function is run on the variables, and everything else inside the monad is all about just recursively working through the structure towards these variables so you can do that replacement. We have that weird script type in there, and we have 2 functions that we care about, extract and instantiate. I'm going to show them being used rather than talk too much about any metaphors for what they might be like. So here we have a function. It adds x to 1, and it is bad because x is a free variable. And we can see it's a free variable by using foldables to list x is free and that. So now let's abstract over x in that function. And that will give us a scope with no free variables. It's actually, that little b represents a down variable. That is good to go. It is capturing things up so we're not going to get any name collisions because the down things have gone away and are now in nameless representation. And you can see no free variables. Now, if we want to go through and replace the bound variables with some term, that's what instantiate is for. And then we get our 3 plus 1. You don't need to know any more about bound than that, kind of thing. Cool. If we take that function x plus 1 and extract over y, rather than the b constructor, we get the layer of f around it. So this is free, but inside the lambda. And then x still appears as 3. And if we substitute all y's for 3 in that, then it unwraps it a little bit, but otherwise, you know, there's no x's to deal with. Or that one more, no, there were no y's to deal with. Cool. Alright. So we've got one little helper function, lamb, which takes the variable to extract over and wraps it up into our term data type. You can kind of see that playing out here, lambda x over our n. Gives us our term type with the scope inside of it, like before. And then we can build up to the example we had before of lambda x plus 1 with some things applied to it. And then we can go through, go find all the variables. If the variable is x, we can get 3, otherwise just wrap it back up in a variable. And we'll have to bother with the screen, but it's done with the same thing. So, that's our one use of abstract.
And this is an expenditure that is in the breakthrough room doing all the replacements in a way that doesn't stop on hands. Take out the function, and everywhere around the boundary will go and replace it this time. So that is, at that point, we've written our own functions that we can run with those rules. We can do stuff with it. We can build booleans and various functions. Don't do that. We already have booleans. But this is cool party that you can do. You can build natural numbers in various ways, in pairs, and then you can do recursion. It takes a repeated look, applies a function kind of forever. You can use that to build, say, for top factorial. Again, don't do that. Just a cool party trick, or maybe calls over something. It's a party trick. That can lead to trouble. If you've got this, and you step it, you end up where you start. So it's not quite stuck, it just happens to not. And that is bad. And as a bonus, there are plenty of stop terms. It's apply two to one. No one I'm familiar with doesn't even use one of them. So, we have types. Right. We add type annotations to all of our boundaries so we know what's going on. And we add a new type, which is the function type, from argument to return. The small step semantics are the same, except we've got our annotations. And now we have our type equals. This is another point where it's good, but it's not all that bad. High level gambles helped. The gambles are a map from variables to types. So any variable we've seen before, we perform in there, and we know what type it has. If we hit a variable and it's in the map, then we just pull that type out. Type checking, and we're good to go. And if X has type T and the context camera, then X has type T, of course. If it's not in that map, then the whole thing is ill typed. Some free variable is snuck in, and we don't know what to do. T app, if we have a term of type T1 to T2, and we apply an argument of type T1 to that, we have T2 out. When we're dealing with the functions, we take the argument of the function, x as type t1, and temporarily generate the context so we can type check little t there. And then we have a function from t1 to the type of t in that information. If we didn't generate that, then we wouldn't know what type the variable was, or we inferred some other type and that function. And at that point, we can type any function. Or any kind of simple type thing we've got this time. We'll work through an example. These are false, probably, and these were the easiest ones to work through the numbers going through. So given no context and this ID function with true reply to it, well, we have application, so we use the T app role and then focus on that function bit. So we bring the context up and we bring the function up. And we already know the argument is type rule, so we're halfway there. And then we have the empty context, and we know the X is a type rule. So we've got a new context, which says X is type rule. And then we need to say, well, what is the type of X? Well, it's cool. And then we have the return type of the function, so we have the type of that. And then we need it to know the type of true, which doesn't need the context, and it's type rule. So the whole thing is type rule. If you stare at these things well enough, and you have three highways, which makes it even easier, then you're good to go. Right, I can implement this in Haskell. There's a map under the hood that looks things up and works in the maybe one ad, so you can print things out to pull the type out. Checking error types is a thing that makes a little bit longer than some of the other rules we've seen. And we need to modify the context on the way through the language. But again, this is just coming up to the problem of the example of the pattern.
So that was inferring, going from term and context to type. We can also check a cheat in this. So here we check that the contents of the map has the right type for the variable. And then for checking the apply, to kind of find out the type of that T1 in the arrow, I actually use infer. So this is called bidirectional type checking. If I wanted to check a type, I could infer it and then check the infer type is what I was expecting. And this is kind of similar to that. I'm using inference as part of my checking and that's fine. There are other ways of doing it. This is convenient and not found on the and then checking around does the same thing, modifying the context. And yeah, now we've rolled out things like Amiga. It rules out tricks, or we can have that in later. It rules out enough, but simply type random characters, or STLC, as it's referred to quite often, is strongly normalized. It always, finite terms always become values in the finite number of steps. It's really got enough stuff that that's really true. If we're happy to give that up, then we can get a request again. And we can actually expect in. I'm going to actually expect in, but we'll do it very quickly. And the point isn't, oh, now I have a fix. The point is, if I'm reading that fix, I'm going to get this kind of thing as input, and I'm going to have to work through the consequences of this and work out what it means for me. So we'll be given the syntax of it. Oh, I'll take a fixed point of t, whatever that is. The small step semantics, we keep stepping the argument, and then we do something. And then there's some type of law that has clearly no connection whatsoever with the small step semantics, but it makes it. Yay! And that's what you'll find. If you pick up a book and go, oh, sections to this is like that again. We have pairs, types for the terms, semantics, and typing. This is how these things are presented with a little bit of, you know, a couple of paragraphs of text. But it's not terrible, right? The type of the first element of the pair, T1 and T2, is the type of first element. It's all notation, it's not hanging two variables and going on if you get the highlight. So, tuples, records, variants, lists can all be similarly added and up a lot of exercise to. And the papers are really top, and we have a bit of a think about them. There are still some things that come. Every time you want an identity function, you've got the annotations, well, we've got two of them, and they're pretty similar at that time. Const, that's what. So it takes two arguments to return one of them. And yeah, don't even do this stuff on the compose function, one of the various versions of that. This is because we have to annotate all of our binaries with a concrete type. And when I give part two of this, it might actually be part three, but someone else has a talk in between, on the way in March, and we kind of plan for that. then I'll talk about how we deal with that. So next time, I'll talk about extensions and fleshing out this thing. So how do you deal with pattern matching, recursive types, user defined archetypes, Hindley Milner fixes the const ID things, you can have universal types and inference, and then system references to it. So that will be future talk. Now, we've given a very different version of this previously. It's in the version 2 folder up here, if you want me to explore the folder or check out slides and click through them or however.